Hi, my name is Joanne Chan. I'm the senior author in a new paper in the Journal of Clinical Investigation. It is the work of my graduate student, Dr. June Kawasaki, in her thesis research. What we did was we looked at the RASA1 genetic mutations that causes arteriovenous malformations and try to figure out what is the mechanism driving this defect. So in my first slide, I'm showing the normal blood vasculature and how it is intervened by a capillary bed. The capillary bed is actually the site of action because that's where oxygen and nutrients are exchanged for waste materials. So first, I would like to acknowledge all of our collaborators and co-authors in this paper. So I'm showing here a picture of patients who have this disease, a varying degree of them. What happens is some people will have very, very mild effects, like a capillary malformation, which is shown on the top corner. Other people would have arteriovenous malformations, these very bad clusters of blood vessels, called a vascular lesion sometimes, and that occurs in the brain or in the internal organs where they might rupture. And if that's the case, the person could die from it. P120 RAS gap is a unique RAS gap in that it has a number of domain structures that are recognized by signaling proteins. For example, it has SH2 domains and SH3 domains in addition to the gap domain. The gap domain is used to turn down RAS action. So our hypothesis is that the disease that is induced by RASA1 mutations, it is called capillary malformation, arteriovenous malformation. That this occurs as a result of impaired FB4 signaling. So without its partner, the FB4 receptor cannot signal properly, and therefore blood vessels don't form properly. So when we look at all these F receptors, interestingly, they all line up with all these tyrosines indicated by yellow in the right places in the juxtamembrane domain. We know that the FB4 receptor is unique among them because it is required during blood vessel formation, particularly in the segregation of arteries and veins. So what we used is a zebrafish model. Typically, we will inject antisense morpholinos into the eggs at one cell stage. This is a 3-day-old zebrafish embryo. It is about 3 to 4 millimeters long, and this fish is actually double labeled with green for blood vessels and red for red blood cells. This is the first region where June was using to look at AV connection. So you can see that the arteries and veins going up and down are distinctly one type or the other. Now this is the caudal region where you can see blood flow all the way through to the tail. And so in this assay, she's trying to figure out whether or not our embryos have complete flow to the tail. This is our first look at what happens when we knock down the RASA1 gene in a zebrafish embryo. And so the embryos were injected at one cell stage, and then we traced it up to 2 days, that is 48 hours post-fertilization. And what we see is that there is an abrupt disruption in the blood flow so that the caudal region is not perfused. And that's indicated by the yellow in the A' picture. What's really interesting, though, is that it is almost a complete match for the receptor that we hope to be its partner. And so what we have here is a knockdown of the FB4 receptor, reducing its function with a morpholino again. And what we see is that instead of completely flowing all the way to the tail, as in A, there is an abrupt stop and there's no flow to the tail. But if you make a cocktail of both the morpholino and the mRNA, you can actually rescue the flow. So that shows us our level of specificity. Now, using this assay, we were able to then mutate those juxtamembrane tyrosines we had shown before into different residues. And this was based on the work of Tony Pawson in 2003. And so what we did was generated mutants in that area. And when we generated the mutants, we were trying to remove the receptor sites that would be able to recruit RASA1. And when we do that, it does not rescue. So this gives us a connection between the receptor and RASA1 as an intracellular partner, an essential molecule that will communicate with the receptor to generate an endothelial response. The ligand and receptor would then touch each other. These ligands and receptors would then turn off RAS signaling, affecting both the MAP kinase and PI3 kinase pathways, and culminating in a downregulation of endothelial mTOR activity. So when we did a number of experiments to test this, when we added a chemical such as the rapamycin drug, which is an inhibitor of mTOR, we can actually rescue the defect in our animals. This drug, as well as two other drugs, were tested because they were structurally different, and all three drugs were able to rescue. So this gave us confidence to then ask this question in patient samples. So if you look at panel A, there is actually very little staining for phospho-S6 or phospho-ERK. So when you look at the three RASA1-positive patient samples that follows, you'll see that each vessel is wider and that the staining is stronger for both phospho-S6 and phospho-ERK. So what we found was when we analyzed 11 samples, 11 out of 11 samples had increased in mTOR-C1. And this indicated to us that it might be possible then to consider the use of rapamycin, which is an approved drug, or other rapalogs, which are in the process of getting approval for use in children or patients who've had this surgery to promote normal vessels to form instead of arteriovenous malformations. This concludes my video abstract. I hope you enjoy our paper. I'd like to note that I've moved to Hampton University now. I'm at the Department of Biological Sciences, affiliated with the Minority Men's Health Initiative. Please contact me at my new address. Thank you.